Okay, I hope you all can see that.
Yes, we can see that. Thank you.
Great, thanks. So, hi, I'm Abram Hindle. I'm going to give a talk tonight about a software developer's perspective on the use of the cloud in sound art. I'm an associate professor of computing science at the University of Alberta. You can visit my homepage at Software Processes or my music homepage at scruntscrunt.ca. Thanks. So fundamentally, for me, the cloud is an abstraction. It abstracts away the fact that we run software on a network of computers that composes the internet. On the internet, we communicate between these computers using common protocols such as the IP protocol, as well as TCP and IP and UDP. The cloud is basically an aggregation of these services. So if we just have a network of services or computers, the grouping of these computers into services is kind of this overlay that the cloud provides. And then the web itself is essentially an interface between those computers and that software, those services for people, for software, and for machines. Effectively, the cloud abstracts collections of services behind these common interfaces. As a software developer, how do I use the cloud? Typically, I use it to provision virtual computers. That is, allocate computers for me to use. These computers might be slices of larger existing computers. Most of you probably use the cloud already to store data and files if you have like Dropbox or Google Drive, something like that. The perspective from my end of the cloud is that it can provide me infrastructure, and that includes things like CPU, compute time, network access, or just storage. I can also have higher level services upon that, which I can build software systems, and that'll be identification and authentication systems. That'll be queues, tasks, any kind of queuing or messaging system, or databases. Then we typically have end user software such as applications. This will be things like communication, like texting or Zoom itself, news, photo galleries, all that kind of stuff. And we also use the cloud to host websites. Effectively, the cloud provides an interface for software to software. It allows software to act as a service and serve other software. It also provides an interface to software for people. What glues the cloud together is the web. The web kind of sticks it all together, and it uses various web technologies such as the Hypertext Transport Protocol, HTTP or HTTPS, or markup languages to draw web pages for you, like HTML, or data languages such as XML or JSON. Effectively, what makes these really work is the magic of names, and names have power. So, in the story of Rumpelstiltskin, you could get control over this mischievous imp if you actually knew his name. His name invoked his power. And this is what works on the web as well. We have two kinds of names. We have the domain name service, and that provides us things like github.com. And we have URIs or URLs, which are basically your web page addresses, such as https api.github.com/user/abramhindle/repos. Normally, web pages are for people, but lots of web pages are for software and computers as well. This one, this API GitHub one, gives you a listing that's computer readable of the software projects I worked on that are on GitHub, and a computer can read that output. So the web is like for people, and the web is for machines, and what really makes the web work is the fact that we have these uniform resource identifiers that allow us to hop between machines and their services. And that's really what the cloud is to me. So, underlying everything, the idea of the cloud was that you wanted computing as a utility. You wanted to treat computing like you would treat electricity from the electricity grid. You flick a switch, you get electricity. You flick a switch, you get compute power. You get 100 computers that you can use. Musically, this is kind of interesting. So, I was really interested in how to have a live performance with people where they take part in the performance by using the performance software that is distributing instruments to the watchers, to the audience of the performance. And this sounded pretty easy off the bat, but you actually run into a lot of issues with trying to give people instruments. First off, your phone doesn't have a floppy disk drive or a CD-ROM drive, and most modern laptops don't either. It's very hard to physically get something onto a phone. Furthermore, I'm not on the Apple App Store. I it's a walled garden. They control what's there. So I'm not on that store. So it's kind of hard to upload stuff to that. You can. But then if I upload to the Apple store, I still got to upload to the Android store, maybe the Windows Phone store and BlackBerry store. That's not fun. This is where the web comes back. It is a common interface. I can actually give you a user interface that is web-based, and you can go ahead and use that instrument. Furthermore, I can distribute it to you via Wi-Fi, and I can use a mechanism that's very similar to the annoying mechanism that you run into when you go to a hotel. That is a captive Wi-Fi portal. So you go to a hotel, you're like, oh, I need internet, and they ask for your credit card. Well, how about instead of asking for your credit card, we give you an instrument to play instead? That's way more fun. So fundamentally, what I want to do is get you onto my Wi-Fi network and then serve you the instrument that you will play. And then you will poke around on your phone, and that will go off to a server, and that server will render the audio and play it out to the audience. So we'll all hear what you're doing on the phone. Okay, so let's hope this works. Alright, so this is an example of the swarm thing, and this is one of the interfaces you could be given. It's basically a weighted spring demo, and as you oscillate around, it makes sound. You would hear this, and everyone else messing around on their phones in the audience would hear it as well. You gotta gamify things, otherwise people play things too much. This gong waits for you to wait time to make a loud gong song. This interface is a shared interface where everyone sees it. Okay, so now this is the live swarmed performance. I hope you can hear it.
Hey, what are you practicing?
Jam it!
So he's using an iPad.
I think it's different. Those have different jams.
Fundamentally allows you to distribute interfaces to the audience so they can collaborate in making music. You have to gamify things such that they don't always just hear themselves playing continuously. So it's kind of problematic in that sense. Okay. So that uses the cloud to distribute the instrument. But what I really wanted to do is I wanted to use the cloud to be the instrument itself. That is to host very large instruments. Instruments where the sensors cost a lot. So ones that use computer vision, ones that use music information retrieval software, heavy AI stuff. I want those to be sensors, and I want a ton of synthesizers, and then I want to aggregate into one computer, and we want to listen to it. But I don't want to lug around like 30 computers.
Sorry, Abram, sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
So I think your audio has just gone very low.
What about now?
Still quite low. Still quite quiet.
What about now?
No, speak again.
Hello, test, test, test.
Yeah, we can hear you. If you just speak a little bit louder, I think just something happened with the sound there.
All right. What about now?
Yeah, that's better. Thank you.
Okay. So fundamentally, I wanted to deploy instruments to the cloud using the cloud as utility computing to deploy instruments anytime I wanted. The problem is how do we hear something from the cloud itself? And we can't just plug our audio cable into the cloud. So we're obviously going to send audio over the internet, but because of that, we induce latency. But at least we could then just take like an iPad or something to a performance venue, and then we could just plug in an iPad and not bring a whole bunch of computers. So this is what the cloud kind of looks like to me. You get instances, you have computers you've allocated, and this would be a user interface that I get for it.
Full sound card in the cloud.
So this is on Cybera. This is a local cloud I have access to that's in Calgary and Edmonton. I've got different computers all allocated, and they're all going to have synthesizers, and we're all going to communicate those synthesizers to one central node, and then we're going to listen to that node. This is the cloud sound card. It's sending silence right now, but it's connected, and if it was playing, you'd hear it. These boxes on this web page control each one of the different computers, and they have a granular synthesizer that sounds like, I don't know, orchestra music? Something along those lines. And so every setting goes to a separate computer and it's generating different sounds, and it gets all aggregated together. All right. That's all fine and good, but my goal was to make music and not to administer a bunch of computers. So unfortunately, what a musician using the cloud would face would be a gulf of execution, whereby you'd have to deal with resource allocation, configuration, and coordination, when really you just had a model of what you wanted to play and you want it to go into the cloud. So what you could do is you could put your model and your resources into an optimizer, and it could then decide what it could deploy into the cloud. So that's kind of what we did. We took a definition of synthesizers hooked up together, the available cloud resources, you tell it to optimize, and it allocates everything to different cloud machines and makes a bunch of scripts that allow you to deploy, to run the thing in the cloud. All right, so we'll go back to that.
So let's make a synthesizer network right now.
So this is just defining a network. Each one of these boxes are going to be a separate little synthesizer. They could be a lot more complicated than they are. They'll be allocated and then deployed to different cloud machines, virtual machines. We're just going to name it, click submit.
And then we can go submit. And when we click submit, it's going to generate a bunch of stuff for us. We can see here that it's trying to deploy it. It's setting up cloud infrastructure. It's logging into lots of computers. And then now it's setting up some of the connectors. And now it's set up a jack trip. So pretty soon, we should hear something. So you can hear what it sounds like.
All right. And so that's the cloud orchestra. So you were capable of deploying and having a very large instrument automatically kind of set up for you, which got around a lot of the issues. So you could have really big instruments with hundreds of VMs. Now, one of the problems with using the computers for music is that you've got to communicate, and you've got to communicate between your user interfaces and your synthesizers. And one of the most common protocols is called the Open Sound Control Protocol, and it's not very secure. I can fake it out pretty easily. And because of that, I could take over other people's performances. And this is dangerous, because if I had a robotic drummer, you could put it into a state that it would self-damage itself. Or you could take a robotic flutist and you could put too much air through it, or make it use too much stuff. Alternatively, people could just abuse the computer itself and make it do other things like generate bitcoins. But probably the worst and most annoying one would be that they just interrupt your performance by hacking your instrument as you're playing it. So that's not super fun. You can get around this. You can rate list, you can limit who can actually communicate, and you can also use a secure Wi-Fi router. This is a lot harder when you want the audience involved. But hacking brings about another interesting thing you can do. You can use hacking in a musical manner. You could use hacking for artistic purposes. So that's kind of neat. So I'm going to show you a bit demo there. Hope you can hear it.
This is GoOSC, So you can see I'm moving it here. GoOSC is an open sound control controller for Android. So it lets me do stuff like... And what's happening is it's basically going and sending those messages to PD over there. Here's what the messages actually look like. So what it's saying is that from that sending to destination port 5712 right there, and from the source port, we're sending the data X, and then it's padded out, and one floating point number, and then Y, and then one floating point number. This is received by PD over here, you can see, as X and one X and one Y. So when I move around, you can see that I'm getting basically floating point numbers saying how far away it is. How do I see these OSS packets? Just sniffing the packets from my network interface.
It's so like
what can
we
do with this? Well, we can do interesting things. The chorus basically sniffs your network interface, looks for OSC packets, and then repeats them. So basically, you get to choose your interface, you get to choose UDP, you get to choose how many times it repeats, and you can choose the delay. And we're going to play to this instrument over here. So let's try this again. So. Jack up the volume a little bit. Okay, now what happens if we use the chorus? So you can hear it repeats messages, and so I can play with that delay a little bit. So we could make the delay quite short, like 0.1, and then we could do it like 9 times. So what we're doing is we're stealing the messages from the network interface and we're replaying them. So that's pretty neat. And so that's what the chorus does.
So by exploiting the protocol, we can do things in kind of a creative way, whether repeating or faking things out. We also use, me and my friend Daryl have used the cloud to communicate audio to each other and do live performances in different locations. So he'd be in Sacramento, I'd be in Edmonton. This is with New Music Edmonton by Whiteout. So I'm doing percussion, and Daryl is doing all the pads, the ambient music in the background and the deep bass. Using software where we're delayed, or musically delayed. We choose to be one bar delayed from each other, and then that way it gets around the fact that it takes about 10 milliseconds to get to Sacramento and back, I think. Sacramento's pretty far. So it's a musically relevant delay, which we just accept. Allows us to Now you can hear Daryl's part. Daryl is visible here and in the chat, but this is his audio. It's kind of hard to see.
Please stand by.
Of cicadas. If you can go to this URL or this URL or this QR code, you can use your phone, iPhone or Android, to simulate cicadas.
So bring out your phones and do that.
Yeah, so get your phone out, go to the web page. If you've got an iPhone, you have to turn it off of silent.
And so they're using a web page of Nabe on all their phones, and the phones are rendering cicada sounds. This is what the web interface looks like. It's got a cicada, which I found in Japan, and recordings of cicadas. You get to choose the playback rate at which the cicada plays back, and you can loop around various parts of the recording. And so the idea was everyone would stand around with their phones, and it would sound like a forest of cicadas. They're very multiphonic if you walk through like a cloud of cicadas. And so this is using the cloud to distribute an instrument to the audience. This is using the cloud to distribute an instrument to the performer. So, I don't want to bring a computer. I want to just use my cell phone. I want to walk up to a performance venue, use my cell phone, and have that be the sole instrument. But I want liveness. If you use your laptop, it just looks like you're checking your email. So, I wanted to do performances that would require a wizard hat and a wand, and also you could just use your phone, and it wouldn't look like you're just playing around on your phone. So what the phone's doing is it's watching you, and it's generating sound based upon your movements, or lack of movements. And it's distributed over the web, it's distributed by the cloud, and all you need is an internet connection or a cached version of the page, and you can play at a performance venue. It's pretty neat. Sometimes it's a little awkward, but that's why it was really cool. This was Edmonton Noise Fest. So this is what the user interface looks like. It's just a web page. And it watches you move. And then it triggers sounds like ocean sounds or synthesizer sounds based upon your movement. It's meant to do a kind of music called harsh noise wall, which is a heavily layered and heavily textured wall of noise that's kind of impenetrable.
In
and
a wartime like fervor,
most people dislike
those in power are asking for the supreme sacrifice of our working class for the economy. This is not a figurative.
You can drag and loop over it. And the idea is you make lots of drag marks and loop marks, and then you can layer it. So here you are, you're adding, you're dragging, and it'll start replaying that sound. And you can just keep wiping over it, and it keeps layering up the sounds and making really interesting texture. But fundamentally, that's kind of harsh noise wall. Gets kind of loud. I know my mom doesn't like it, but whatever. Okay, so what did I talk about? Cloud is a utility. What the cloud is to developers, basically utility in terms of services and infrastructure. What do I want to do? I want to put instruments in the cloud. I want to deliver instruments via the cloud. Also discussed security issues with the cloud and possibly using hacking in a creative way. I also showed you various performances whereby instruments were deployed to users via, or audience members, sorry, via the cloud, and using the cloud to reduce the equipment cost of the actual performance. If you're interested in any of those instruments, they're all down here, the Wall Looper, Magic Cell Phone 3, Cicada. And if you want to talk about it further with me, just email me at hindlewan@ualberta.ca. So if you got any questions, I'm definitely open for them.